So as I said, I'm a historian. I teach history. I try not to intervene in the present moment too much. All the advantages that a historian has come from retrospect. But events of the past few years have forced people like myself, historians, to confront the relationship between the past and the present in a new way. So I'm going to talk to you about totalitarianism. I'm going to talk to you about modernity and postmodernity. And let me begin with modernity, which is a term that historians throw around a lot and perhaps seems quite vague to most people, since it's used in so many different ways. Historians conventionally date modernity with 1789 and the storming of the Bastille, the French Revolution. That, of course, is a very French-centered approach. But for our purposes today, I want to say that what's important about modernity is it's that moment in history, let's talk about European history, where identity ceases to be a given and becomes a question. It's also the moment when God is pushed aside. Initially, God is simply pushed aside, off stage, relegated to a minor role, and that's the 18th century. And by the end of the 19th century, the 1880s, Nietzsche, Dostoevsky, God is actually killed off entirely. And after God has been first relegated to a minor role and then killed off entirely, the great task of modernity, of modern thinkers, becomes replacing God. What can you find that will fill in for God? Of course, the short version of that story is that it's really, really tough to replace God. You know, God is very multifunctional. You know, God usefully serves epistemological, ontological, ethical purposes. God helps us guarantee that we know the world. You know, God tells us something about what it means to be. God conveniently seems to hold some kind of ethics in place. So once you've gotten rid of God, you have a big space to fill in. And a lot of modernity in intellectual history is about replacing God. And liberalism comes out of the Enlightenment philosophy, which is the beginning of an attempt to replace God. And I won't go into too much detail, but I want to talk for a few minutes about the fragility of liberalism and how we can understand the fragility of liberalism given its origins. Liberalism was in some sense a political codification of Enlightenment philosophy. And the short version of that story is that Enlightenment philosophy was based first and foremost on the exaltation of reason, of human reason. You push God to the side and you put human reason in place. And it's a very optimistic philosophical tradition. The idea is that through the use of our reason, we can come to know the world, to understand the world. And as we come to know and understand the world better and better, we can then use that reason and that knowledge we gain through our reason to fix that world, to make it better and better. Social engineering projects have their origins in this kind of philosophy. It's a yes, we can kind of philosophy. You make reason into a kind of God. You replace God with human reason. And the short version of that story is that the weakness of liberalism has proved to be the fact that it is existentially thin, unsatisfying. The German philosopher Edmund Husserl argued as he looked at the rise of Nazism in despair, it was a superficial understanding of reason. It was superficial because human beings are more than just reason. We are also will. We are also desire. Reason does not exhaust the identity of human beings. And the romantic reaction to enlightenment was largely about opposing enlightenment reason with romantic will, with romantic passion. And the romantics countered Descartes' idea of I think, therefore I am, with I will, or I want, therefore I am. That it's desire, not reason, that grounds human identity. And let me read you just a couple quotes, because the great prophet of the weakness of liberalism was Dostoevsky. And you'll have to excuse my very bad accent in Russian, but this is from Notes from the Underground, Zapiske iz Podpolya. Rasudok, gospoda, jest vyesh kharoshaya, eto besporna, no rasudok jest tylko rasudok, i udolet vorjajat tylko rasudoshnie sposobnosti człowieka, a chatienie jest projadlenien wsiezizny. You see, gentlemen, reason is unquestionably a fine thing, but reason is no more than reason. And it gives fulfillment only to man's reasoning capacity. While desires, chatienia, are a manifestation of the whole of life. Dostoevsky goes on, Tagdato eto vsia vi gavarite, nastanu nove ekonomicheski atnashenia, sosem uj gotovi i tože vichislenia i matematicheskuyo tochnosto. Tak što v adin mig izčeznut vsia vazmožne vaprosi. Sospinja patamu što na nik poručajet vsia vazmožne atvjeti. Tada vistrojica hristalnje dvorec. Tada. Nu, adnim slovom, tada prileti ptica kagan. Konječno, nikak nije za garantirovat eto už je tebi gavaju, što tada nije bude, na primjer, užasno skučno. Potom što, što že i djela je to, kada vsija bude razčislena pa tabličke. Zato vsija bude čerizvičajno blagorazumno. And then, all this being said by you, new economic relations will follow. Ready-made and also calculated with mathematical precision, so that all possible questions will disappear in a single instant, since they will all have been provided with answers. In short, halcyon days will arrive for mankind. Of course, it is impossible to guarantee, and this now is myself speaking, that life will not become, let us say, dreadfully boring. On the other hand, though, everything will be extremely reasonable. And Dostoevsky's diagnosis of the weakness of liberalism from over 100 years ago kind of continues, turns out, to have much relevance today. In 1989, when communism falls in Eastern Europe, the political scientist François Fukuyama famously, or perhaps now infamously, declared the end of history. And he was speaking very much in the spirit of an Enlightenment liberal teleology of progress. Because we have reason, because we use that reason, things will get better and better. Maybe we don't have all the answers now, but as Isaiah Berlin said, life is like a jigsaw puzzle, and all the answers are out there somewhere. And maybe we don't have all the pieces right now, but eventually they will all be found, eventually they will all be put in place, all problems can be solved, all questions answer. If not today, then someday, as we come to know the world more and more. And the liberal teleology of progress, you know, was part of this faith in reason, that things would get better and better. And what we've now been discovering, of course, is that there is no end of history. There is no guaranteed liberal teleology of progress. The codification of Enlightenment philosophy that liberalism was then assumed in 1989 to be the thing that would take over the world. And many people thought that now we move towards liberal democracy everywhere. And there was very little thought given, in fact, to the distinction between liberalism and democracy. The fact that people can democratically vote against liberalism. The assumption was that using their reason, people will naturally come to this kind of a political ideology that guarantees freedom of speech and human rights, and the civic rights of the individual. And then there was an additional thought that the European Union was going to be some kind of guarantee of liberalism, that as more countries were admitted into the European Union, as the European Union expanded, this would be a guarantee. First it would be an incentive, and then it would be a guarantee. And certain things could not possibly go wrong once everyone was in the European Union. And that, of course, has also turned out to be very much an illusion. We saw Viktor Orban come to power in Hungary, who is explicitly declaring himself and the leader of an illiberal democracy. We saw the growth of an explicitly fascist Hungarian party, Jobbik. We saw the election of a neo-Nazi party, Ars Slovakia, and Slovakia's parliament in March. Marian Kotleba and the Ars Slovakia party openly support the legacy of Jozef Tiso, the leader of the Catholic fascist Slovak Republic that existed under Nazi tutelage between 1939 and 1945. In May of this year, Adam Michnik, returning to Poland after some time away, said, if we look at what's happening in the whole region, Russian, Ukraine, Slovakia, Hungary, we see everywhere the same virus, which still has no good definition. In October of 2015, the right-wing populist party Pravo I Spravedlivost, Law and Justice, won 37% of the vote in Polish elections. It was a minority, but still the liberals were split, and it led to a parliamentary majority. And that began a fundamental turn in Poland. A turn that many liberals in Poland couldn't have imagined seeing in the 21st century. It saw, among other things, a return to what in Polish is called Nowa Mowa, a kind of new speak, a kind of totalitarian language. And Michał Głowiński, the great literary theoretician of Newspeak, who wrote about it in Samizdat in the 70s and 80s, now is a much older man, has been giving interviews again, analyzing this neo-totalitarian language that has returned to communist discourse. And Kaczynski has said things like that the opposition is composed of people who have broken every principle of culture after the tragedy in Smolensk, who step on everything that is holy in our culture. There's been a return to public discourse of phrases that are reminiscent of the Stalinist era that people never thought they would hear again. One of the things that initially struck me was that soon after peace came to power last year, one of my friends, who's an editor in Poland, forwarded me a letter that the new foreign minister had written to the British Broadcasting Company in London, protesting a critical portrayal of the new government by British television. And the letter said, that in fact, in Poland today, Panuje radosnie nastroj, veseloje nastrojenia, and it's a joyous mood. But the English kind of fails to do justice because it's all about the affect of the words. I mean, for me, radosnie nastroj is from the Stalinist era. You wouldn't use that word. You wouldn't use that phrase unless perhaps you were talking to a baby or to a two-year-old. There's been an introduction of all sorts of new words like dobra zmiana, a good change, Volksdeutschenia, which is kind of extraordinary because it comes from the word Volksdeutsch, which, as most of you probably know, refers to Poles who signed up, so to speak, during the German occupation of the Second World War, of having some German origin so that they could have privileges under the Nazi occupation regime. And of course, that word, Volksdeutsch, signing the list as a Volksdeutsch, is seen as betrayal, as collaboration with the German occupier, as collaboration with the Nazis. And now it has taken on a new meaning, Volksdeutschenia, which is a kind of verbal noun, to be a Volksdeutsch, or to do something Volksdeutsch-like, now means to return to the European Union with a request for Brussels to investigate constitutional violations of the new government. Perhaps most striking and most popular in discourse is the phrase used by the new government, Najgorszy sort Polaków, the worst sort of Poles, which is a kind of postmodern version of wrag narodu, you know, enemies of the people. And it's a kind of language that a couple years ago seemed impossible. And it's a return of a language of populism, of nationalism, of romantic will, opposed to Enlightenment reason. It's an expression of a desire to assert one's identity, to find a safe space in this world, to distinguish oneself from others, to fail to take responsibility. And I would argue that we see on both sides of the Atlantic at the moment a real crisis of responsibility. This has come together with a revival of what in Polish is called polityka historyczna, historical policy. This is something else that has no real English equivalent. But it refers to the idea that the state should take control of asserting a certain historical narrative, one that emphasizes Polish innocence and victimhood. There's a revival of the spirit of a 2007 law that was passed in Poland that makes it punishable by up to 3 years in prison for, quote-unquote, imputing to the Polish nation complicity in the crimes of Nazism or Stalinism. Now this was, of course, when it came out, my historian colleagues in Poland said, well, this is very vague. Imputing to the Polish nation, does that mean the Polish nation in the abstract? Does that mean the government? Does that mean the majority of members of the Polish nation? Does that mean any Pole anywhere? My colleague Dariusz Stola, a historian of the 20th century in Poland, wrote a wonderful essay in Gazeta Wyborcza at that time in 2007 saying, well, now we know that everything bad that happened to this country in the past 100 years was done by Martians, because obviously we had nothing to do with it. But that's been happening, you know, in fact, everywhere. I mean, we saw Putin rehabilitate the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact. We saw a whole discourse of gay ropa, which is eerily reminiscent of the conversation about the protocols of the elders of Zion, except that now instead of Jews, we're talking about a homosexual worldwide conspiracy, but both refer to something that is somehow felt to be connected with bad Western decadence, manipulation. We've seen Viktor Orban kind of cavalierly and publicly and with impunity inhumanely treating thousands and thousands of refugees, including children. You know, in Poland, you've seen this wave of attacks on foreigners, on anti-Semitic campaigns against political opponents, regardless of whether or not those political opponents are actually Jewish in any way at all. That seems to be irrelevant. But very much in the style of the so-called anti-Zionist campaign of March 1968, there's been a return to the language of genealogy, of conspiracy, of denunciation. Just last week, my colleague Jerzy Kochanowski, who is a Polish historian, a professor at the university in his mid-50s, and he was riding on a tram in Warsaw together with a mutual German colleague of ours. And they were speaking in German because Jerzy speaks excellent German and our German colleague doesn't speak any Polish. And some guys came up to him on the tram and said, "This is Poland, stop speaking German." You know, and Jerzy explained that, well, you know, he couldn't speak to his friend in Polish because his friend didn't speak Polish, and that was why they were speaking German. And then they beat him, and he ended up in the hospital, and the tram driver refused to call the police. It's not that the government is calling for people to be beaten up on trams, but there's a sense of the borders shifting, of a space opening, of a kind of license for racism and violence. Let me just mention a couple more things before I move on to talk about post-modernity, which is what I'd really like to talk about today. The potency of the narratives that are spewed forth by these governments, the license for hostility, for antagonism, for racism, for violence, as well as for sacrifice, has been a kind of extraordinary and terrifying thing to watch. Almost a year and a half ago, I was talking with a friend in Russia, an old friend who I've known for many years, who is one of the gentlest, kindest people you would ever meet, a translator of English literature into Russian, who married in middle age and moved with her painter husband out to the countryside. She is not somebody who has ever done anything opportunistic in her entire life. She has only ever sacrificed herself for other people. She has never had any money. She will never have any money. She will never benefit from any of these regimes. And we were writing about Ukraine, and she hadn't wanted to talk to me about it because I'm American. And finally, she wrote me this long letter in Russian. I read Russian better than I speak Russian, for those of you who are listening to my terrible accent. But let me just read you the end of it. And she said, "Жаль, что Украина большой нам не друг. Спасибо Западу. Бедная Украина оказалась разменной картой в игрушках Запада против России. Наверное, только это и можно сказать в качестве эпитафии. А дальше Марси, как Бог даст, время покажет." And the sad thing was, and it was a very long letter in which I understood that she really believed that the Maidan was an American conspiracy directed against Russia, was an American-sponsored fascist coup designed both to attack Russia and to oppress Russian speakers in Ukraine. She had no selfish reason for believing this, and she's not a stupid person. I mean, she simply believed it. And for me, the very sad irony was that my friends in Ukraine who were getting shot at on the Maidan, not only did they know that it was not an American conspiracy, but they were desperately waiting for some kind of international support. They were desperately waiting, you know, for someone to come and help them and show solidarity. You know, and you know, we handed out some cookies on the Maidan, but basically Americans did nothing. And I didn't know what to say to my Russian friend. The whole thing seemed very sad. There was little solidarity forthcoming. Let me move on now to kind of put this in the context of what I'm going to call postmodernity. And everybody will have their own understanding of where modernity ends and postmodernity begins. But I'm going to give you my own definition, in which I tend to date postmodernity as a kind of coherent intellectual current from 1968 and the death of Marxism. But what's important about postmodernity in intellectual history is that it's the moment when we give up on replacing God. If modernity is all about an attempt to fill in for God, to find something, be it history with a capital H, or be it human reason, to take God's place. Modernity, postmodernity is when we give up and we decide that no, not only is there no God, there's also no ersatz God. There's no substitute God. There's no what Derrida would call, there's no transcendental signified. There's nothing that holds subjectivity stable. Nothing that holds meaning stable. Nothing that holds truth stable. There's a kind of unhinging. And this speaks to what the Polish philosopher Leszek Kołakowski liked to call the epistemological question. And the epistemological question, which sounds like a big fancy word, epistemology just refers to knowledge, to the study of knowledge. How do we know the world? How do we know anything? The epistemological question in its most basic form is, how do we know the world exists? How do I know that this bottle is really here and it's not just a projection of my consciousness? How do we get from mind to world, from consciousness to being, from subject to object? How can I ever get outside of my own head and know that there is this mind-independent reality? How do we move from immanence to transcendence? They're all different ways of stating the same problem. How do you find this bridge between consciousness, between human consciousness and the world? The epistemological question is the problem of the bridge, the how do we know the world exists? How do I know that this glass is here? And God was your guarantee, which is very convenient, that the world exists, that God would not deceive you. And once you get rid of God, then you have to find some kind of substitute route to truth. And once you get to postmodernism, you give up. You give up on finding that bridge between subject and object, and I'll get back to that in a moment. But let me now talk about this a bit in the context of Russia, and I want to talk for a few minutes about a book that I suspect many of you have read by Peter Pomerantsev, who is a Kievan-born British television journalist and political analyst, called Nothing is True and Everything is Possible. Which I think is an absolutely remarkable book. It's gossipy and it's voyeuristic, and it's written in a very light, chatty style about gold diggers and the mistresses of oligarchs and supermodels and gangsters. But the light tone is deceptive. I think it's arguably the most philosophically perceptive text about Putin's Russia that we have. And Peter writes there not only about moral ambiguity at the heart of what's going on in Russia, because morality is not the only object of ambiguity in this story. In Putin's Russia, reality itself is suffering from ambiguity. And he describes Putin's Russia as a fragile reality show choreographed by political technologists. He describes a role of mass media that is dazzling, like the effect of the new money. And he describes the disorienting juxtapositions of the pre-modern and the post-modern, the oligarchs and the peasants, the kind of the glittering dance clubs and the moldy Soviet-era prison cells, the warlords who use Twitter. And I want to now pause on this idea that reality itself is ambiguous and contradictory. And this problem of the bridge, of how you know the world exists, of how you know anything is true. And I want to talk a little bit about truth and lies. And one of the things Peter's book caused me to do was to return to an essay that Hannah Arendt wrote in 1967. And I should immediately confess that I love Hannah Arendt, and at any given moment of extreme political or intellectual crisis, I always think it's a good moment to return to Hannah Arendt. In this case, I returned to an essay I hadn't really thought carefully about before. It was called Truth and Lies. And in that essay, Hannah Arendt begins by distinguishing two kinds of truth. She distinguishes what she calls philosophical truth, a priori truth, from factual, a posteriori, empirical truth. So philosophical truth would refer to things that are eternally, universally, transcendentally true. The fact that 2 + 2 = 4, or Kant's categorical imperative that you should always treat people as an end and not a mean. Truths that are not contingent, that could not have been otherwise. Truths that are in some ways transcendental, that are prior to human experience. Empirical truth, in contrast, refers to factual truth, things that happened, and therefore are contingent. And Arendt gives the example of the fact that German troops invaded Belgium in August 1914. That's an empirical truth. It happened that way. We experienced it. But it did not necessarily need to have happened that way. It could have happened otherwise. It is true, she writes, considerably more than the whims of historians would be needed to eliminate from the record the fact that on the night of August 4th, 1914, German troops crossed the frontier of Belgium. It would require no less than a power monopoly over the entire civilized world. But such a power monopoly, she adds, is far from being inconceivable. And arguably that distinction she makes, which is not a distinction we use so often in English, philosophers will use a distinction between a priori truth and a posteriori truth. Truths that are prior to experience and truths that are after, come after experience. But it arguably matches up somewhat with the distinction in Russian between istina and pravda, which my friend Yurko Prohasko has been writing about since we had this panel discussion in Kiev about Peter Pomerantsev's book. This distinction between istina and pravda, which we don't have in English, the transcendental truths and the empirical truths. And of course, it's empirical truth that in some sense is most relevant to the political realm, but is also most vulnerable. Because as Arendt says, empirical truth always contains within itself the vulnerability of its original contingency. Because at any given moment, things could have happened otherwise. In fact, strange and unexpected things happen all the time. And therefore, somebody who would like to lie is always in a position of being able to create a narrative that would in fact make more sense, even if it's empirically untrue. And then she goes on to make a second distinction, now focusing just on empirical truth, factual truth, things that happened but might have happened otherwise. And Arendt says that before these modern totalitarian experiments, we had in politics the old-fashioned lie. And what Arendt describes as an old-fashioned lie, she describes as a tear in the fabric of reality, as if you were tearing a piece of paper, you know, or a rip in a sweater, or a tear in a pair of pants. And she says that when reality was torn like that by these old-fashioned lies, the careful observer could still, through penetrating observation and attention to inconsistency, discern the place where reality had been torn. When we get to the middle of the 20th century, to Nazism and to Stalinism, she says we have a fundamentally different kind of lie and a fundamentally different kind of assault on empirical truth. She said the modern political lie is seamless. It is a complete reconstruction of reality in such a way that there is no tear. There's no tear to perceive, because reality has been reconstructed in such a way as to be perfectly smooth, perfectly seamless. And I'm going to speak in a moment what it means to go from the modern political to lie to what Peter Pomerantsev is describing as the postmodern experience in Putin's Russia. But let me first do this by way of an anecdote about the communist experience. Some of you may know, I think there are a few Poles in the room, and even those, some of you may have seen this film, who are not Polish. There's a 1981 film called Przesłuchania, The Interrogation, that was made during the Solidarity era in Poland. It stars Krystyna Janda in what is arguably her most extraordinary performance. For those of you who haven't seen it, I recommend it, although it's an extremely unpleasant film. You know, essentially, in a claustrophobic way, it keeps you for 2 hours in a Stalinist prison cell. It's an attempt to do what in German is described as Nach Erlebnis, you know, you're kind of projected into that space. But Krystyna Janda in that film plays Tonya, who is a young, beautiful nightclub singer in the post-war period, in the Stalinist era in Poland. And Tonya is thrown into prison, you know, and accused of being the lover of a spy, of a Western imperialist spy. And in the beginning, she's completely confused and doesn't understand what's going on at all. She's obviously not a very political person. She's, on the contrary, a somewhat kind of decadent young woman who likes dancing and singing and wine and men. Yeah, and during the process of her interrogation in Stalinist prison, you know, she is pressured and tortured into confessing to more and more, to increasingly larger parts of the narrative that her interrogators are inflicting on her. Although never to the entire thing, she always to some extent resists. And at the end of the film, we never find out what really happened. We never find out which of these various men were actually her lovers. We never find out if any of these men was actually a Western spy. We never find out if one of these men was her lover and was a spy, if she knew, if she cared. We never find out the truth. So at the end of the film, there is what in philosophy you would call epistemological unclarity. There's lack of clarity about knowledge. There's lack of clarity about truth. We don't know what the real story is. At the same time, we are given to understand, and this is never stated, but it's in my reading, it's the most important message of the film. We are given to understand that there is a true version of the narrative. We don't learn what it is in the course of the film, but we are meant to understand that there is a true story. The truth is out there. You know, there was a real Tonya. She had real relationships with people. Some things happened, some things did not. And it's not a postmodernist free-for-all. There's a real truth. Even if we don't figure it out, it's still there. And it's there independent of whether or not we know what it is. So So in philosophical terms, you would say we end the film with epistemological unclarity, but not ontological unclarity. There's lack of clarity about knowledge, but not about being. We are meant to understand that there is a truth. And what Peter Pomerantsev describes in Nothing is True and Everything is Possible is actually a step beyond this epistemological unclarity that you have in the Stalinist period, and that Hannah Arendt describes as a seamless reconstruction of reality. Because you actually have not only epistemological unclarity, but also ontological unclarity. He's describing a world in which not only is there lack of clarity about truth, but there is actually a sense that there is no more truth. There is no more underlying real version. He's describing a situation in which not only is there a new seamless false reality that has been constructed, but there are simply a multiplicity of seamless alternative realities that have been constructed, each as real or unreal as the next. So you peel off one, and you have another alternative reality, which is no more real or unreal than the first, and you peel that off, and there's another alternative reality. But there's no sense that underneath there's some kind of ontologically stable truth. There's a kind of unhinging. You know, what in German you would call Bodenlosigkeit, a groundlessness. Underneath, there's no truth. There's nothing underneath. And Peter is describing a state among the media and among journalists in Russia in which there's a kind of collective resignation to the fact that there is no real ontologically stable truth. There are simply a multiplicity of alternative realities. And given that, we have to take it lightly. And he captures this in the slogan, "Everything is PR." And there are various ways in which I think this is played out, or in which I feel like he hit upon something that might not explain everything, but certainly explains very many things. One of the things that struck me during the Maidan, and I was on sabbatical in Vienna during the Maidan, and so I was in, for purely coincidental reasons, a strange situation of reading a lot the press in English and German and in Polish as well as in Russian. But the comparison between the English and German coverage and the Polish coverage was quite extraordinary, because it was not just that the Poles were more sympathetic, but the Poles understood things that the English and German journalists didn't understand. And one of them was provokatia, which is a word that doesn't even quite work in English because it's not deep in our tradition in some way. But the politics of provokatia, the idea that people can be somehow planted or paid to pretend to be other people or pretend to be precisely the people they don't like in order to do something that in principle the government doesn't want done, but in fact will create a pretext for some kind of repression. And you can have multiple levels of provokatia. You know, people being paid, you know, from tituski to hooligans to fake gay pride protesters, you know, to impersonate other people. And that this can be done on multiple levels, and you can get to a point where it becomes very unclear who is who, and who has lost track of who they are because they've gotten caught up in the role that they're paid to play. My friend Katya Mishenko described this in an essay she wrote during the Maidan as feeling like she had to constantly pinch herself to make sure she wasn't dreaming, to constantly make sure that you knew who you were talking to and that this person wasn't really pretending to be somebody else who was pretending to be something else. And of course, the politics of provokatia, which far predate postmodernity and go back at least to the 19th century in the Tsarist Empire, became profoundly postmodern. They became part of a kind of crisis of truth. At the beginning of the war in the Donbas, I was talking with a friend in Kiev about how to figure out who is a Kremlin agent and who is a mercenary and who is encouraged with some financial incentive to act on already existing authentic inclinations and who's behaving completely authentically out of conviction and who began as a paid provocateur but has gotten caught up in the script and who no longer knows who he is himself. And I said to my friend Vasil, I said, you know, I sense that the politics of provocation have led to a crisis of subjectivity, that people don't know who is who. And he smiled and said, yes, we're very postmodern. Let me just say a few more words about postmodernism in Ukraine. I'm finishing a book about the Maidan now, and this was something I was really trying very hard to figure out. And one of the things I got caught up on was the concept of provocatia, which as a historian is irresistible because it's a concept with deep historical roots that makes a postmodern comeback. But also this idea of prodajnost, corruption. But it's also, prodajnost is a word that we don't exactly have in English. Because you can say corruptia, I mean, there's corruption, and it is corruption, but it also, in a kind of existential sense, encompasses the meaning of salability, the sense that something can be sold or someone can be bought and sold, that someone can sell oneself. This you can say it in Polish, you can translate into Polish, but you can't really translate into English. And the book I'm writing is in some ways, you know, about my friends and colleagues and what led people like myself, in a kind of self-centered place to start, what led my friends, people who have lives and families and careers and ideas, you know, and rich and interesting lives to decide that they were willing to get shot. But there were also some other interviews I did because the opportunity arose and I found it irresistible. And one of them was with these two guys named Ruslan and Zhenya. They wouldn't tell me their last names. From Pravi Sektor, who fought on the Ukrainian side in the battle for the Donetsk airport. And they were fascinating to talk to, because normally I'm talking to writers or translators or philosophers or people I know from my own work. And while they might be saying things out loud to me for the first time, I'm not really asking them about anything they haven't done a lot of thinking about themselves. And they're people who spend a lot of time thinking about how to articulate things. But the fascinating thing for me about talking to Ruslan and Zhenya was that it was not just that, you know, maybe the first time they were talking to a crazy American, or the first time they were talking to a historian, you know, or the first time they were giving an interview. It was as if it were the first time they were trying to put their thoughts and experiences and feelings into words at all. Like they had no words initially to describe why they felt the way they did, why they made the choices they did. And so I was asking them about things like, you know, why did you choose Pravi Sektor? And they kept coming back to this idea, which they kept kind of repeating like a refrain, nas nie kupisz, nas nie kupisz. And let me read you something that they said to me. Dla nas Pravi Sektor, eto jeszcze I jedynstwena struktura, która nie prodała I która nie prodaje. Budući w nie, mi ubiedili, że ludzie, którzy создали prawy sektor, którzy działają wsie dla niego, oni nie prodażni. Nas nie kupisz. And I felt like they kept coming back to this, ja nie znaję, jak wam objasnić. Nas nie kupisz, nas nie kupisz. And this idea of prodażność. And I began to realize that it wasn't just political and it wasn't just financial. It was this feeling that how can you trust anyone in this world where there's so much corruption that everyone has his price? And you have to find some space in that world where you feel like people won't sell out, or use some space of authenticity. And they were looking for authenticity, but they never would have used that word. But this idea of how do you find a grounding in a world in which it seems that everyone can be bought, and therefore you never know exactly who anybody is. And this idea of prodajnost, which I felt like was taking on this postmodern meaning. You never know who is real or what is real. And let me just tell you two more anecdotes that I've been kind of fascinated with. You can already tell that I'm a very impressionistic historian because I love anecdotes. Svetlana Boy, my recently deceased colleague from Russia, used to talk about the irreducible anecdote. You know, the seemingly tangential story that in fact reveals or illuminates what's actually going on. One of my very young colleagues in Poland, Paweł Pieniążak, is a very young reporter who's been reporting on the war in the Donbas. And he wrote a fantastic book of reportage called Postrovenia s Novorossii, which should be read by more people, although I don't think it's translated into any other language but Polish, so that probably limits its readership. But Paweł was reporting from the Donbas during the first months of the war. I think he did a fantastic job. But one of the stories he tells is how he, as this young Polish man wandering around the Donbas, would find himself, you know, in the middle of these battles, and people start shooting. And the local people are coming up to him, even though he's a foreigner, and saying, "Nashi? Nashi?" You know, and Paweł is trying to figure out who is Nashi? Who do they consider ours? It's another thing that's very hard to translate. Ours? Are they our guys? Are they on our side? And he's trying to figure out who at any given moment they consider to be on their side. And it's often unclear that they know themselves. You know, they want to know who's on their side when everybody is shooting. And and what Paweł captures here is that it's a seemingly absurd question, Nashi, Nashi, but it's actually very profound. You know, who is who? You know, and who do we think we can trust? And let me just tell you, maybe this will be the last thing I will read to you in my terrible Russian accent. A story that my colleague Katya Yakovlenko from Donetsk told me after she left for Kiev. And she was one of the curators of a kind of art discussion collective called Izolatsia in Donetsk. And after Izolatsia's space, what was taken over by the separatists and turned into a prison, Katya and her colleagues relocated to Kiev together with Izolatsia. And this is a story she told me when I was in Kiev. And she was trying to describe to me what it was like to be in Donetsk at the beginning of the war, when all these different people were arising. And then she starts telling me about the day that the Chechens arrived. And she said that, you know, first they didn't even speak Russian very well, and then they couldn't understand why they were getting hryvnia instead of rubles from the bank machines. And then they organized this meeting on Lenin Square, and I'll read you this story. Oni prostě pojavились na ulici jak zelení člověčky v Krymu. I vše, i dlačevo, i pačemu oni tam pojavились, nikdo neznal. Oni ustravili meeting. Byl očím směšný epizod, kada kagaja tam babuška městnája, sumašetšaja na plošadi Lenina, centrálnoj. Čečen se krestila na boj s ukrajinskými nacistami. No to je Čečinci, oni že nie pravoslavní, plus plošad Lenina, která je, jak by vůbše nie odnosit se k pravoslaviu, i vod oni je okrestit za to, čo by on pošel ubývat tam lidé. I love this anecdote, because you have the Christian woman on the communist square giving an Orthodox christening to a Muslim soldier so that he can go defend a language he doesn't speak very well himself by killing non-existent Ukrainian Nazis. So everything is fiction, nothing is true, and yet it's all happening. And I feel like this was the world that Peter was trying to capture in this book. What does it mean to find yourself in a world in which nothing is true but everything is happening? You know, and Katya felt like she was sort of tearing her hair out, like you bang your head against the wall. What can you do? She's like, it's completely surreal. It's like things that don't go together at all, that don't make any sense, that are mutually exclusive, that are all fictional. You're living in these multiple fictional realities. And the multiple fictional realities contradict one another, but you're there anyway. And it's like there's no underlying truth. You're just caught up in these multiple fictional realities. Okay, let me in the last couple minutes speak about, maybe against my better judgment, but somebody I was having dinner with here last night said that I should say something about Trump because you would be interested, and because I seem to be the token American at this conference.
No, hi, Washington.
Oh, okay, there's another American. Excellent, okay. So I'll say something briefly about Trump. And the fact that I'm, well, let me maybe start with this. For most of my adult life, I felt like a kind of bezrogni kosmopolit, that I spend a lot of time abroad. I don't feel particularly American. I don't feel particularly anything else either. I write about Eastern Europe. I don't write about American history or American politics. And there was something about Trump's candidacy that returned my Americanness to me, because I realized that I could listen to Putin or I could listen to Kaczynski with some kind of analytical distance, with some kind of intellectual distance. I could take notes, I could kind of perceive certain things, I could figure out what was going on. Not that I liked them or thought they were nice people, but still I could watch. You know, I listened to Putin's whole Crimea speech on YouTube. And I didn't feel like I'm going to be sick, I have to turn it off, you know, even though I didn't like it. But when I watch Trump, I actually feel like I'm going to be sick, I have to turn it off. I actually can't stomach it. And it's that visceral, very primordial reaction that returns my Americanness to me. But let me say something about him. His supporters list as one of the most important, if not the most important reason for their support, Trump's honesty, his alleged honesty. And they're looking for honesty. They feel like Washington has become corrupt, which is largely true. And in that sense, they're not so different from Ruslan and Zhenya, you know, looking for, you know, a place, or Nastya Kupich. But the interesting thing here is that, of course, honesty in this case does not refer to any kind of connection between what he says and empirical reality, precisely in the sense that Arendt was describing it, because there is no connection. There's no relationship between what comes out of his mouth and empirical reality. He's not even in that game. I mean, he's not even really trying. He's not constrained in any way. There's no correspondence, and he doesn't, in a very cavalier way, he doesn't feel constrained by the need for there to be any correspondence. There was a beautiful satire in The New Yorker about the fact checker who faints from exhaustion at the end of the Republican debate and has to be hospitalized to recover before the next one, you know, which is a joke, but not really a joke, like a lot of these satires. So honesty here has nothing to do with truthfulness. And yet there is something to what his supporters see in that honesty. They see a kind of authenticity, which is not truthfulness, but is rather the rejection of repression. Precisely in the sense that Freud describes in Civilization and its Discontents, das Unbehagen in der Kultur, I think it's Nedovolstvo Kulturo, the Russian translation. But Freud in his famous Civilization and its Discontents, you know, tells, and this is one of the reasons he loses the intellectual battle to Marx at this time, because Freud says civilization is based on repression. That, you know, at the heart of each human being are these instincts of eros and thanatos, that we have lust and we have aggressiveness, You know, and that there is no way to have civilization without repressing those instincts. And therefore, civilization will always doom us to unhappiness because it will always involve the repression of instinct. But Freud says there is no other way. The alternative is barbarism. And this is one reason Marx sounds so much more appealing here in the 1930s, because Marx is promising a happily ever after, that ultimately you overcome all contradictions and we all live happily ever after. For Freud, there's no happily ever after. You know, in the best case, with a lot of psychoanalysis, you can kind of more come to terms with your repression, you can alleviate some of your neurotic symptoms. But basically, we're doomed. You know, that's the nature of the situation. But what Trump does is he comes along and he rejects repression. Yeah, and people find that liberating. And it is liberating. The rejection of repression is liberating. But the cost of that is the destruction of civilization. This is Freud's revenge in our post-communist world. This is really, it's the moment that Dostoevsky describes in The Brothers Karamazov, "Vsyo pozvolono." You know, now everything is permitted. That's incredibly liberating. You feel freed. You feel authentic. But it's basically just like saying, you know, now if a man walks down the street and sees a woman, you know, and it comes into his mind that he would like to rape her, why not say that aloud? Because we're rejecting repression. Maybe he authentically feels that way, but there are reasons not to say that aloud. You know, it's precisely by not saying that aloud that civilization exists. He is the return of the mob, exactly in the sense that Arendt describes the mob in Origins of Totalitarianism, where she makes this distinction between the mob and the masses. And she says the mob, which is going to come to lead the masses, this was Hitler, the mob pulls the curtain on bourgeois hypocrisy. The mob is the dark underside of the bourgeoisie who pulls the curtain on bourgeois hypocrisy, and the bourgeoisie secretly delights in having the curtain pulled on its own hypocrisy. And the mob then becomes the leader of the masses, who are the previously politically indifferent and or disenfranchised majority. Trump's original advisor, who has now been forced out, was Paul Manafort, who was Yanukovych's advisor. Instead of Ukraine becoming more like us, we're becoming more like Ukraine. But moreover, and Paul Manafort is American. We have a whole industry now. Peter was absolutely right about this. We have a whole industry of specialists in marketing for gangsters with presidential ambitions. It's PR for gangsters, and it's become a kind of a science. My friend Ivan Krastev, the political commentator, said that, you know, Trump is not a sign that America is something Europeans can't understand. On the contrary, Trump is a sign that the United States is becoming more like Europe. Like Putin, in some way, you have this experience of an inversion of the relationship between reality and reality television, in which reality television is now the reality, you know, in which anything completely absurd, you know, can still be said. I promised you I won't read you anything more in my bad Russian, but I'm going to read you one more sentence because I can't resist it, because it encapsulates Yanukovych's absurdity for me. This is from the interview that Yanukovych gives to the BBC after he's already fled to Russia about the ostriches. Ich sto pohovov tom, sto ya podderzhival etik strausov. Ani prostye zhili tam. A mnie zakryli glaza I prostye chadit I ničego nie vidjet. I love that line. Like, but what's bad in the fact that I supported the ostriches? They were just living there. I mean, I'm supposed to go around like I close my eyes, like I don't see them. Trump sounds like this. This is what Trump sounds like. The cult of American individualism is not saving us from fascism. On the contrary, it's only contributing, because it's an American refusal to recognize the power of social conditions over individual behavior. Social scientists call this the fundamental attribution error, that we always overestimate the role of individual personality variables and fail to appreciate the power of social conditions over individual behavior. And watching Trump, and a lot of my American friends and colleagues are saying, don't worry, he won't win, he can't win. And if he wins, we have a system of checks and balances. It can't all collapse. Unfortunately, I don't feel like that. It's like people saying about the Titanic, but this ship can't sink. It can sink. American democracy, American liberalism could be over very quickly, unfortunately. Okay, I'm gonna finish now because I'm probably talking for too long. My colleague Marcin Krul in Warsaw said recently that the spiritual crisis of our age is that we have stopped asking ourselves questions. We've stopped asking ourselves metaphysical questions. We've stopped asking ourselves where evil comes from. And I want to just say one or two things about that. I was in St. Petersburg in May for a discussion that was part of a series called Debates on Europe. The topic was very vague. It was largely a German-Russian conversation. And the conversation about the current crisis of the world somehow seemed to kind of get reduced to who counts as a European. You know, obviously somehow the Germans count. That's beyond discussion. You know, and then are the Poles full Europeans? Well, now we consider them. Well, what about the Ukrainians? You know, could they also be Europeans? And if the Ukrainians, also the Russians? This is a very funny conversation for an American to watch because it starts to seem like a fetish, as if. If you're not European, does that mean that human rights don't apply to you? Does that mean it's irrelevant? But in any case, there was a big discussion about who counts as a European, and a big discussion connected to that about whom should apologize to whom. No, it was a lot about kto kavo, kto vinovat, and pokajania. Everyone wanted to talk about pokajania. And I felt like, again, as the only American at that conference, that the whole conversation about apologies and pokajania and repentance is beside the point. It's a way of avoiding the real question. Here we have Germans and here we have Russians, and we're looking back at the legacy of the experiences of Stalinism and of Nazism. And we should be asking ourselves the question, under what conditions and circumstances does morality completely break down? What are those conditions? We have experiences, you know, of horror. We have experiences of grotesque catastrophe. How did that happen? What are the conditions and circumstances that allow it to happen? And how can we avoid having that happen in the future or in the present? It's not about who should apologize to whom. It's about avoiding catastrophe. It's about understanding what, you know, Czesław Miłosz said, the habit of civilization is fragile. It's about understanding that fragility. My colleague Anna Shor-Chuzovskaya in Vienna, a sociologist in Vienna from Kiev who works largely in Russia, was recently in Russia doing some interviews, and one of the questions she was asking was, how do we prevent a repeat of something like Stalinism happening again? And then when she came back, she was telling me in Vienna, she said, Marcy, not only could people not answer the question, they didn't understand the question. They were thinking about Stalinism as if it were, she said in German, Naturgewalt, some kind of act of nature, of natural violence, like a tsunami or an earthquake. Like in the best case, if there's a rainstorm coming, you can have your umbrella with you, but you can't prevent the rain, it just comes. And I think that's exactly the place that we have to be working on. So the topic of this conference is, you know, from Kant's famous essay, What is Enlightenment? I teach this essay every year at the beginning of my intellectual history course. I was happy to see it on the program. What it means to dare to know, what it means to be in a world in which there is no safe space where other people will know for you and take care of you. It takes us to the Chto delat question. You know, what to do, what can we do? And since I have no brilliant answer about what should be done, I'm going to leave you with something that Leszek Kołakowski said about the problem of the bridge and the problem of the search for truth. And Kołakowski said that all modern attempts in philosophy to get from the subject to the object, to find some kind of guarantee that we can know the world, that there is epistemological clarity, that there is something like absolute truth, that we can reach it. He said all such modern attempts have failed. And they will all fail because the problem of the bridge is insoluble. There is no magical passage from inside to outside, you know, from consciousness to being. But, he says, the moral imperative is to keep searching. Because if you give up on truth, if you stop believing in truth, then you have given up on morality. Okay. Thank you.